Through the motivating examples, I believe you have gained some intuitive understanding of value-function approximation. Now let's formally introduce the topic in the second section, which contains many subsections. This section is very important in this lecture because it reveals the fundamental ideas and concepts of value-function methods. Once you understand this section, learning the subsequent algorithms in sections 3, 4, and 5 will be much easier. Let's first look at the objective function. V pi s is the true state value of s, and v hat is its estimated value. Our goal is to make the estimated value as close to the true value as possible. The structure of the v hat function can be a linear function that corresponds to a straight line or a parabola, or a nonlinear function represented by a neural network. Once the structure of the function is determined, what we can adjust is w. What we need to do is to find the optimal w that makes v hat as close to v pi as possible. Thus, this problem is essentially a policy evaluation problem. Given a policy, I need to find a function v hat that closely approximates its state value. Later, we will extend this to estimate action values and then to find optimal policies. So, we'll study step by step. Let's first see how to do policy evaluation. This is similar to the TD algorithms we introduced in the last lecture. Our goal is to find the optimal w. How to do that? There are two steps. The first step is to define the objective function, and the second step is to optimize this objective function. So, let's first look at how to define the objective function. This is the objective function for value function approximation. The objective function JW, where W is the parameter we want to optimize, is defined as follows. It equals an expectation of the squared error between the true state value and the estimated state value. Here, our goal is to find the best W to optimize this objective function. It's worth noting that S here is a random variable. A random variable must have a probability distribution. What is the probability distribution of S? This question can be asked in another way. Since there's an expectation involved, what does this expectation essentially do? It averages over all states. How should this average be calculated? The concept of probability distribution of states may be confusing for beginners, so we will explain it in the following. We have several methods to define the distribution of S. Here I introduce two. The first one is the easiest to think of. It is the uniform distribution. It means that I treat all states as equally important, and I give every state the same probability or the same weight when averaging. If I have n states, then each the probability or weight for any state is 1 over n. In this case, according to the definition of expectation, we get the right-hand side. This is the probability. Normally it should be inside, but I've taken it out because everyone's probability is the same. So what does this value represent? It represents the sum of the squared errors of the estimated values for all states, then averaged. Although this uniform distribution is very intuitive, there is a problem here. That is, it assumes that all states are equally important, which might not actually be the case. For example, if my goal is to start from a certain state and reach a target state, then the target state and states close to it are more important. Conversely, some states that are very far from the target state may be less important. We hope to give more weight to those important states. As a result, the estimation errors for these important states will be smaller. For the less important states, their weights are smaller. Even if their estimated errors are larger, it doesn't matter much because the agent might not visit them at all. With this idea in mind, we introduce the second probability distribution, the stationary distribution, which is widely used in value function methods. The stationary distribution is a very important concept as it describes the long-run behavior of a Markov decision process. I introduce it briefly now. Later, an example will make it clearer. More details can be found in my book. What does long-run behavior mean? It means that I start from a certain state and take actions according to a policy, continuously interacting with the environment while adhering to this policy. After taking actions many, many times, the agent can reach a stationary status. Then I can tell the probability of the agent appearing in any state. You'll understand this better through an example later. For now, we just need to know it is a probability distribution, and I denote it by d pi. D pi s is the probability at state s. Since it is a probability distribution, the probability at each state S must be greater than or equal to 0, and the sum of all probabilities should equal 1. In this context, based on the definition of expectation, the objective function can then be written in this form. Here, dpi essentially acts as a weighting factor. If a certain state has a larger weight, then the estimation error for that state will be smaller. Another implication of dpi is that it represents the probability of the agent appearing in that state after reaching a stationary status. Let me elaborate a bit more on stationary distribution. First, it's a distribution, a probability distribution of states. If you are calculating a weighted average, you can think of it as the weight of that state. Second, it is called stationary distribution because it represents the probability distribution reached after taking many steps following a specific policy, thereby reaching a stationary status. The stationary distribution is also called steady state distribution or limiting distribution. It is important to define the objective function in value function methods. It is also important in policy gradient methods, as we introduce in the next lecture. Let me demonstrate through an example, which I believe is very helpful. Consider this example. I have a policy. This policy, as you can see, is an exploratory policy. Every action has a positive probability of being chosen, but there is also a greater probability of choosing a specific action. So, it has certain tendencies. For instance, in these two states, it tends to move downward, to the right in this state, and there is a high probability of staying still in this state. Given this policy, we let the agent start from any state and then run many times according to this policy. Let's see what will happen. Suppose I have a very long episode starting from a state. This episode visits every state many times. The number of times that the agent visits state S is denoted as n pi s. The ratio of n pi s to the total number of state visits, which is the length of the episode, is what I show in the graph below. This ratio can approximate the stationary distribution. First, let's look at the graph below. What does it tell us? The x-axis represents the steps of this episode. We've run an episode that has 1,000 steps in total. The y-axis represents the ratio defined above. You can see that the ratio, or the probability of visiting different states, varies. Initially, the fluctuations are quite large, but as the number of steps increases, it eventually converges. So, what does stationary mean? What does long run imply? It means that after many runs, it tends to be stationary, and each ratio or probability will converge to a specific value. Let's examine state S4 more closely. It corresponds to the purple line at the top. This line shows the number of times S4 is visited divided by the length of the entire episode. It eventually converges to this ratio, which is relatively large compared to other states. The reason why this ratio is relatively large is quite easy to understand. In every state, there is a greater probability of choosing a specific action. These actions, no matter from which state you start, have a high probability of leading to state S4. After many steps, the probability of the agent appearing in S4 is high, approximately equal to 0.7. You might have noticed I've marked some stars on the graph. What do these stars represent? They represent theoretical values. This means I don't need to run many iterations to find dpi s. We can also calculate it from theories. Let's look at this equation that dpi s must satisfy. This ppi is the state transition matrix. Do you remember the equation vpi equals rpi plus gamma ppi vpi? This is the Bellman equation in matrix vector form. The matrix ppi mentioned here is that ppi, and each element inside it represents the probability of transitioning from S to S prime. From this equation, you can see that dpi is a left eigenvector of ppi, and its corresponding eigenvalue is equal to 1. For our 2x2 example, it's not hard to write out this ppi. If you're interested, you can pause the video and check if ppi really looks like this. Then I can calculate the left eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue equal to 1. Each element inside it corresponds to the probability of each state in the long run. You can see that the value corresponding to S4 is 0.72, which is the same as the numerical value we showed just now. That's a brief introduction to the stationary distribution. It has a very rich connotation. If you are interested, you can check out my book for more information.